Welcome to Back to the Bible with pastor and Bible teacher Bryan Clark. The impact of sexual sin and its destruction can be felt in almost every family. So today, Bryan shares the warnings and instructions given in Proverbs to help you win the day, even in a sexually toxic culture. All right, let's join Bryan for today's message.
He's handsome. He's successful. She's beautiful, she's sexy, she's got the world figured out. They meet somewhere, in a club, in a bar, at work. There's clearly a chemistry between them. And within a few hours, they leave together. They will spend a beautiful night together experiencing sexual pleasure that's deeply satisfying, deeply fulfilling. Maybe over the next few days, maybe the next few weeks, they will experience this deep, soul-satisfying experience together again and again. And then they will go their separate ways, no hurt feelings. Both deeply thankful for how this experience has deeply enriched their lives. That is the story of sexual pleasure put out by Hollywood. I would suggest to you there's more truth in an episode of SpongeBob than Hollywood's version of sexual pleasure. What is the true story, the true narrative of sexual immorality? Well, that's what we want to talk about. If you have a Bible, turn with us to Proverbs chapter 7, verse 1. My son, keep my words and treasure my commandments within you. Keep my commandments and live, and my teaching as the apple of your eye. Again, sounds very Proverbs 4-ish. This is a theme that reoccurs again and again in the Proverbs. But the value of God's truth, to treasure God's commandments. This idea of keep my commandments and live is the reminder that God isn't just some control freak that wants to put out a bunch of laws to control your life. It's that he wants you to experience more. The concern is that you will settle for less when he wants more. How do you have more? Well, you live his way, follow his commandments, and live. The idea of the apple of your eye, the literal Hebrew there is the pupil of your eye. It kind of became a saying. It's the idea that if you look at somebody's eyeball, right at the center is the pupil. And it kind of looks like an apple. It was the idea of the phrase then came to mean the center of your life. Just like the pupil is the center of the eye. So it's the idea that God's truth, God's commandments, God's treasures would be the center of your life. Bind them on your fingers. Write them on the tablet of your heart. Say to wisdom, you are my sister, and call understanding your intimate friend. So it's to value God's truth as if it's an intimate friend, as if it's a family member. Why? In this text, verse 5, that they may keep you from an adulteress, from the foreigner who flatters with her words. Now this word adulteress, it's a word that literally means strange or alien. Some translations have the strange woman. Basically, the idea is it's an imagery of any sex outside of God's design, God's purpose. Understanding God's purpose was one man, one woman, in a lifelong, one flesh relationship called marriage. Any sexual activity outside of that is considered alien. It's considered strange. It's outside of God's intent. And there are consequences to pursuing sex in that way. Before we move on, it's worth noting that the text just said that if you pursue God's truth, if you treasure his commandments, if you make them the center of your life, it helps you walk uprightly, to walk in moral purity in a very sexually contaminated culture. Now, I would not say to you that all you need to walk uprightly sexually in this culture is to read the Bible every day. I think there's more to it than that, but I would also say there's not less to it than that. In other words, that has to be an essential part of the strategy. You have to take the text at face value. God just said, if you understand and believe my truth, it will keep you from involvement in sexual immorality. Our friends at the Bible Engagement Center, their research shows that if you engage the Word in a meaningful way at least 4 times a week, it demonstrates significant life change. So we kind of use that as a bit of a target, that at least 4 times a week, we're actually in the book. Now, if you struggle in this area of sexual purity, then let me give you something super practical. Make it a goal that you are in God's truth 4 times a week and in passages specifically related to this struggle. So the 4 passages I'm suggesting are Proverbs 5, Proverbs 6, Proverbs 7, and then I'm going to add 1 Corinthians 6, starting in verse 12. If you reread those every week, so that's 4 times a week, I'll suggest one of 2 things will happen. Either you will find yourself growing in your desire for sexual purity, or you'll stop reading the passages. But the text basically says, if you pursue God's truth and treasure it, it will help you in this area.
Many people want to be in God's Word daily, but where do you start? And how do you keep going? Well, if that's something you struggle with, we can help with an exciting variety of free daily Bible reading plans for you. Choose from Bryan Clark's 21-day Bible reading challenge, or maybe you'd like our 6-month reading plan. We also have chronological and historical plans. They come directly to your email, only take about 10 minutes a day, and include a few questions to help you process what you've read. It's a great opportunity to move forward in faith. So get started today at backtothebible.org. That's backtothebible.org. Now let's return to Bryan Clark with today's message from Proverbs 7.
Starting in verse 6, the writer of Proverbs begins to tell then the story. For at the window of my house, I looked out through the lattice. This would be like a second-story house, which was typical. The lower level had animals and stuff, and typically the residence was on the second level. So just imagine sitting in the window, looking out, it's evening, and seeing this story play out in the streets. I saw among the naive and discerned among the youths a young man lacking sense. So a couple of things real quick. One is, don't get too lost in the imagery. It's not saying the boy is innocent and the woman's the seductress. Basically, the idea is we're all the boy. It's this idea of imagery that we're all vulnerable to temptation. And the idea of the woman or the seductress is basically all of the temptation to experience sex outside of God's plan and purpose. It would be the strange woman, the alien behavior. So at the end of the day, that's the point. He calls the boy naive. The word means just what we think it would. It's to be simple-minded. It's to lack discretion. What we would say in our language today is relatively clueless. So he's out in the street, but he's naive, he's simple-minded, he's rather clueless. I think it is worth noting that in our contemporary culture around this conversation, Christians are perceived to be simple-minded. were perceived to be kind of puritanical, kind of close-minded and narrow and unenlightened, kind of gullible, whereas the rest of the culture is sophisticated and they're enlightened and they're open-minded and they're much more worldly wise. But according to God in this text, it's the polar opposite. It's those who experience sex outside of God's intent that are actually very naive. They're gullible, they're simple-minded, they're rather clueless as to what the cost of that is. Where it is the people of God who see it from God's point of view that are actually quite skillful and discerning and better understand the issues. The idea at the end of verse 7 of lacking sense, literally the Hebrew is lacking heart. It's the idea that the young man actually lacks the internal motivation to do the right thing. So the father's been counseling him, trying to share God's way, do the right thing, but the son isn't buying it. The son is determined to experiment a little bit, have his own way, doesn't really buy into everything his dad's saying, and lacks the internal motivation to do the right thing. This is actually a really important part of this whole discussion because it's very easy to get wrapped up into what I refer to as sin management. You can unplug the computer, you can put filters on your computer, you can get certain software, you can have accountability partners, you can have all these things in place, which may be well and good. But if at the end of the day, there isn't a passionate desire in your heart to do the right thing, none of those management techniques will ultimately win out. The only way you ultimately win out and walk uprightly is if deep in your heart you really, truly, passionately do want to do the right thing. For parents raising young people, raising teenagers, it's not enough just to take away a phone or put a filter on it or put software or the computer or any of that stuff. If you don't somehow teach them deep inside their hearts to genuinely, passionately want righteousness, none of that stuff will ultimately prevail. And that's what the text is saying. This young man lacks heart. He lacks the internal motivation to do the right thing, and that becomes obvious here. Passing through the street near her corner, and he takes the way to her house. So he's not just out for a stroll in the park walking the dog and bumps into this woman. He knows exactly what he's doing. He's hanging out in her neighborhood. He's walking down her street. He's hanging around her corner. I talked about this danger of trying to define kind of this line between the ways of the world and the ways of God in order to get as close to the line as possible without going over it. Eventually, you will go over it. That's the way it always works. That's exactly what's happening here. He's not buying into what his dad has explained to him. He's cruising her neighborhood. He's walking down her street. He's hanging around her street corner. It's clear what he wants. Verse 9, in the twilight, in the evening, in the middle of the night, and in the darkness. Notice verse 9, it progressively gets darker. From twilight to sundown to darkness to the dark of night. There's just this imagery that he's moving from the light into the darkness, and there will be a consequence to that. Verse 10, and behold, it's as if we see the woman with the father looking out the window, and behold, a woman comes to meet him, dressed as a harlot and cunning of heart. The phrase cunning of heart carries the idea that she is not just out for a stroll, finds a young man, falls in love. She is a predator out hunting down a simple-minded, naive fool. Again, don't get too lost in the gender stuff of this. It's simply saying that there is a force that's coming after you, with the intent of luring you in and destroying you. It's any sexual behavior outside of God's intent. It is interesting in verse 10 that the text mentions she's dressed as a harlot, and what's implied in that is that will be very attractive to him. Now here we tiptoe into very delicate waters. But I think it's important for women to understand how God has made a man. I hear a lot of women say, you know, men just need to get over it. Well, you have to talk to God about that, because God's the way that's wired up a man this way. And you can't just summarily dismiss that. Part of the struggle with so many men struggling with pornography and some level of sexual struggle is that the temptation is virtually everywhere. It's at the mall. It's at work. It's on television. It's the commercials. It's the billboards. You virtually can't go anywhere without some level of temptation. One expert described it as an alcoholic walking around with a bottle of whiskey in his hand. There's just always the temptation that close, and eventually he's going to give in. That's part of the problem of this particular struggle. So think about this. If roughly 68% of men are struggling at some level with pornography and those images that are getting stuck in their head, and how that then creates how they look at the women around them, it is a huge problem. You have men that genuinely want to walk in purity. They're really struggling through this thing, and they're trying to do the right thing. So it's helpful to create some place of refuge. Some place, maybe the only place, literally in the community, where they can come and there isn't this constant temptation, where there isn't this vulnerability, where it isn't just one more place where I'm distracted and struggle. But we would mutually say, okay, I understand, this is a big problem. And people are coming here, guys are coming here to try to find Christ, to try to get truth, to try to do better, to try to walk uprightly. It'd be really helpful if they could come into a place of refuge where rather than being distracted, they're actually encouraged and supported. Some of you ladies, your motive may be nothing other than just being fashionable. But you just have to be aware of what's going on with the culture. It's a huge problem. And for the sake of others around you that may be struggling, to at least be aware of that, and can't we work together to create a place of safety and a place of refuge? How was that? Fairly delicate, yes? Let's quickly move on now. Verse 11, she is boisterous and rebellious. Boisterous means kind of loud. It means kind of aggressive. It's a really helpful way to view everything that's coming at you in this culture as it relates to sexuality, whether it's TV commercials, whether it's at the mall or the internet or even a coworker or a fellow student. There's just this sense it's aggressive and it's coming at you with an intent to destroy you. That's a big part of the struggle. Her feet do not remain at home. She is now in the streets, now in the squares, and lurks by every corner. Notice in verse 12, the repetition of the word now. It carries the idea that she gets around. We would probably use the word she sleeps around. Now she's on this street. Now she's in this house. Now she's on this street corner. In a couple of verses, they're going to be kind of this presentation that she's going to present herself as pursuing this young man because he's handsome, because he's good looking, because he's a good athlete, because she's fallen for him. But the truth is, that's absolutely ridiculous. She does this night after night after night. What she's looking for is somebody that is so gullible, so simple-minded, so clueless that the predator can take down another victim. And so that's the idea, that tonight, now she's here, then she's there, tomorrow she's there. She's devouring whoever is gullible enough to listen to her. Verse 13, so she seizes him and kisses him. with a brazen face, which means defiant face. She says to him, I was due to offer peace offerings. Today I have paid my vows. Therefore, I have come out to meet you, to seek your presence earnestly. I have found you. The language is, I have come out and I have seen you and I have fallen in love with you because you're wonderful and you're so handsome. When the reality is she's a predator looking for a victim.
Here's Bryan with a few added thoughts to help you move forward in faith today.
Recently, I was looking at a Bible of a godly woman who recently passed away. I've known her probably since I was in elementary school. She was 88 years old when she died, and her son let me look through her Bible, and it was just full of notes and markings. You could tell it was a Bible that was well read. One of the things I noticed at Psalm 119, verse 11, she had written in there, your word have I hid in my heart that I may not sin against you. Her son told me that pretty much every morning his mom got up early, sat in her chair, read her Bible, and it was as regular as clockwork up until physically she couldn't do it anymore, and that was just a few weeks before she passed. To me, it was a reminder that godly people don't just become that way by accident. Proverbs 7 agrees that we avoid sin by believing and keeping to God's truth as the center of our lives. So we're talking about sexual sin, and I think we all understand sexual sin is everywhere and that the enemy's out to get us. The Proverbs warns us not to be naive. So you have to want to walk uprightly, and if you're serious about that, then you have to spend time in the Word of God. The proverb says, keep my commandments and live. Here at the Bible Engagement Center, we've figured out that you need to be in the Word of God at least four times a week to really have life-changing impact. So I'd encourage all of us to at least be in the Word four times a week. Psalm 119, verse 105, surely this lady had three stars by that verse. Thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I think the writer of the Proverbs would agree that's the key to skillful living.
You're listening to Bryan Clark here on Back to the Bible. Thanks for listening. Come back tomorrow as Bryan shares more wisdom to help you move forward in faith here on Back to the Bible. If you'd like to listen again, visit backtothebible.org or find us on your favorite podcast app.